بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله حمدا كثيرا طيبا مباركا فيه، مباركا عليه كما يحب ربنا ويرضى وكما ينبغي لجلال وجهه وعظيم سلطانه، والصلاة والسلام على أسعد الخلق وخاتم الرسل محمد صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وصحبه التابعين ومن تبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين. ثم أما بعد، I'm glad to be joining this seminar even though I miss being there, but inshallah this video at least will give to you some of my thoughts and convey some of my aspirations from you in terms of that seminar. In this quick note, I'm actually trying to make a case for Maqasid al-Sharia. Maqasid al-Sharia, as you know, are the purposes and the objectives and the principles of our Sharia that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has revealed to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. ثُمَّ جَعَلْنَاكَ عَلَى شَرِيعَةٍ مِّنَ الْأَمْرِ فَاتَّبِعْهَا. He revealed the Sharia as the Islamic way of life, as the ahkam and the rules that we follow. But the rules do not go without a why, without a reason, without a sabab or illa or hikmah. We can talk about the differences between these terms, but basically there has to be a reason behind the rules, and a reason even behind the aqa'id, behind the articles of faith. If we start with the articles of faith, we know that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is al-Khaliq, al-Raziq, al-Rahman, al-Rahim, al-Malik, al-Quddus, al-Jabbar. Subhanahu wa ta'ala, He has names. Teaching us about these names, subhanahu wa ta'ala, are not in vain. They are for particular purposes. There are maqasid, even for the aqa'id, even for knowing that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is al-Khaliq. In the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, مَا أَصَابَ مُصِيبَةٍ فِي الْأَرْضِ وَلَا فِي أَنفُسِكُمْ إِلَّا فِي كِتَابٍ مِّن قَبْلِ أَن نَبْرَأَهَا إِنَّ ذَلِكَ عَلَى اللَّهِ يَسِيرٌ لِكَيْ لَا تَأْسَوْا عَلَى مَا فَاتَكُمْ وَلَا تَفْرَحُوا بِمَا آتَاكُمْ. So he said, subhanahu wa ta'ala, in Surah Al-Hadid, that he had put everything that he created in a book, in a record, so that, لِكَيْ لَا, so that. And that is a reason, that is a maqsid, that is a wisdom, a hikmah, behind teaching us about that book that he has, subhanahu wa ta'ala, لِكَيْ لَا تَأْسَوْا عَلَى مَا فَاتَكُمْ, so that you are not sad with what you miss, and you are not too proud of what you achieve, and so on. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the Quran almost never mentions a hukm without a tadhyil, without a comment after the hukm, so that we know the maqsid of the hukm. So when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, for example, talked about as-siyam, يَا أَيُّ الَّذِينَ أَمَنُوا كُتِبَ عَلَيْكُمُ الصِّيَامُ كَمَا كُتِبَ عَلَى الَّذِينَ مِنْ قَبْلِكُمْ, and so on, and He gave ahkam for as-siyam, He said, يُرِيدُ اللَّهُ بِكُمُ الْيُسْرَ وَلَا يُرِيدُ بِكُمُ الْعُسْرَ, so that He wants to facilitate things for you and He does not want them to be hard on you or harsh. So He subhanahu wa ta'ala gave us a taysir or facilitation, which scholars of Islam had counted as one of the maqasid, one of the purposes, one of the objectives of Islam and the ahkam, is to do this taysir, to give us facilitation, to give us an easier approach to life. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in a number of verses in the Quran has this method of teaching us about the wisdom, about the reason, about the purpose. In the Sunnah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, also we find a lot of looking at this maqsid, at this irada. What did the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam arad? Mada arad? The companions used to ask this question, what did he mean by what he said? Not what he said in literal understanding. For example, Hadith Bani Qurayza, we all know that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam sent the companions to Banu Qurayza after Al-Ahzab, and he told them, لا يصلينا أحد عصر إلا في بني قريظة. Do not pray عصر until you reach بني قريظة. And then in the middle of the road, Maghrib almost came. So they had a debate between those who said, we pray عصر before Maghrib, And those who said, the Prophet ﷺ said, do not pray Asr except in Bani Qurayza. Those who looked at the language, when we look at the dilalat, at the languages, لا يصلينا أحد العصر إلا في بني قريظة. No, none of you should ever pray Asr today except in Bani قريظة. There is nothing in the Arabic language that is more tawkid, that's more confirmed, that is more in the umum, the general, that is more in the ihkam, that is precise and clear. This is a clear text. But the clear text means something behind it. So some of the companions said, إِنَّمَا أَرَادَ الْإِسْرَاعِ. He meant that we go fast. He did not mean that we really change the rule of Asr and we pray Asr at night, as some of them did. The other said, إِنَّمَا أَرَادَ الْإِسْرَاعِ. He wanted us just to go fast. So he said, pray Asr in Bani Qurayza. And then when they came back to the Prophet ﷺ, they told him about those who prayed and those who did not pray, and he approved both of them ﷺ. Which means that if you look at the letter and you have a certain consideration in looking at the letter, then you are right. And if you look at the maqsid, if you look at the wisdom behind what the Prophet ﷺ said, then you also have a point and you have a valid understanding and you have an ijtihad that is maqbool, that is a valid ijtihad. It's not an invalid ijtihad. The prayer of Asr in Banu Qurayza is a very historic, if you wish, kind of example. But there are so many very important topics that we approach today in which we need to know, what did the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam arad? ماذا arad? What did he mean sallallahu alaihi wasallam when he said or did something? What was his intent? What was the maqsood of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam? Was the maqsood for something to be tashri', to be an obligation for every Muslim and Muslima until the end of time? Or was the maqsood, was for the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam to give us an example of a tashri'ah, an example of a siyasa? Imam al-Qarafi, one of the great imams of Maliki school, has a very important farq in his book Al-Furuq. And we all know in the 36th farq, he said, farqun بين تصرفه صلى الله عليه وسلم بالتبليغ وتصرفه بالإمامة وتصرفه بالقضاء وهذه التصرفات لا آثارها في الشريعة. He said, there is a difference between the Prophet's action صلى الله عليه وسلم in the capacity of being a conveyor of the message and the capacity of being an imam and the capacity of being a judge. And these capacities and these intents have an implication on the Sharia, Imam al-Qarafi said. And then he goes on to give some examples. He said, he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when he said, فَبَعْثُ الْجُيُوشِ وَصَرْفُ أَمْوَالِ بَيْتِ الْمَالِ وَتَقْسِيمُ الْغَنَائِمِ. He said, when you talk about the issues of بَيْتِ الْمَالِ, the public trust, and how he divided the money of the public trust, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, this is not ahkam ثَابِتَة. These are not fixed ahkam. The dealing with the public money and so on has to go with the morals of Islam, of course, al-adl, justice, and people have to take according to their rights, and so on. And there should be no riba, and should be, and so on. But how he divided, sallallahu alayhi wasallam, the money of the public trust is a matter of siyasa, is a matter of policy, is not really a fixed part of the sharia. He said, وَتَقْسِيمُ الْغَنَائِمِ. And therefore, the way he divided the غنائم sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, even though some of this is mentioned in the Quran, وَعْلَمُوا أَنَّمَا غَنِمْتُمْ مِنْ شَيْءٍ فَأَلَّا لِلَّهِ خُمُسَهُ وَلِلْرَسُولِ وَلِذِ الْقُرْبَ. So he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam divided those, you know, five parts. And now nobody, no scholar of Islam says that غنائم have to be divided like that, or that بيت المال has to be divided like that, or the issues in which the Prophet ﷺ had done siyasatan. So he made a treaty with Quraysh for Hudaybiyah. He made a treaty with the Jews of Medina. Nobody said that any treaty with Jews anywhere has to be exactly like the Jews of Medina's treaty. You could have a treaty and you could have a war. He also had a war, ﷺ. What is the difference between the war and peace? It is the maqsood. What did he mean? What was the wisdom? What was the purpose behind the treaty? In Islam, you could have a peace treaty and you could have a war. You could have a division of Bayt al-Mal on the poor, and you could have Bayt al-Mal asking people to donate for Bayt al-Mal. You could have different ways of calculating zakah and different ways of collecting zakah. You can have different court systems. You could have multiple levels of courts. You could have a single level. You could have one qadi. You could have a number of qadis. In other words, when we look at the maqasid of what the Prophet ﷺ did in the public life, and I'm not talking about the ibadat here, I'm talking about the public life and how to manage society. When he did ﷺ that, when you look at it from a maqasid perspective, then you are freeing the Islamic philosophy from the literal understanding that might not be suitable for the place and time. You are freeing every aspect of the Islamic philosophy, the Islamic political philosophy or political theory, if you wish, the Islamic economics or philosophical economic look in Islam. When you talk about society and its organization, when you talk about urban planning and water resources and the environment, when you talk about family and its policies and management and all of that, when you talk about contemporary world and contemporary arts and contemporary literary expressions and so on, all of this is free from the literal understanding. They are not free from the values. They are not free from the principles, because nothing is principle free, even technology. Technology is not value free. It is full of values and ethics and a philosophy. There is a philosophy behind a computer or a car or a pen or a fridge or whatever it is that you see that is part of technology. There is a philosophy behind it, and there is science behind it, and science is not void of ethics, is not void of meaning, right? Meaning in Islam is given by maqasid al-sharia, by looking at the sharia not in the literal sense, not in the ahkam sense, but looking at the sharia in the moral sense, in the meaning sense. Well, does this mean that there are no ahkam in the sharia? Of course there are. But then maqasid al-sharia differentiates between maqsad al-ta'abbud and the other maqasid. Maqsad al-ta'abbud is the maqsood of having an act of worship. So when we pray, when we do zakah, when we do hajj, when we make wudu, these are all acts of worship that the Prophet ﷺ said, صَلُّوا كَمَا رَأَيْتُمُونِي أُصَلِّي. Pray as you see me pray. In the hajj, he said, خُذُوا عَنِّي مَنَاسِكَكُمْ. Copy me when you do your hajj. But he did not say, copy me when you do war and peace. He did not say, copy me when you do trade and markets and all of that. He did not say, copy me when you think about planning a city or developing a country. In the sense that we need to copy his morals and his meaning, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and his maqasid, other than maqsid al-ta'abbud. Al-ta'abbud also has a very important component, which is the definition of sin in Islam. The definition of sin are ta'abbudiyat. You know, Allah forbid al-qatl wa-sariqa wa-zina wa-sihr. All of these are ta'abbudiyat. Murder, theft, adultery. This is defined in Islam in a fixed way. This does not go with the maqasid and the social good and all of that as we understand it. No, it goes with al-ta'abbud. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made certain women haram to marry, for example. That is ta'abbudi. Any of this that is broken is a sin in Islam. He made certain foods haram to eat. الميتة والدم ولحم الخنزير وما أهل لغير الله به والمنخنقة والموقوذة والمتردية والنطيحة إنما حرم عليكم الميتة والدم ولحم الخنزير. And so on. This is ta'abbudiyat. This is, you can't deal with pork with some chemicals and then say that became halal. No, it is ta'abbudi. Liquor and anything that makes the mind absent, not just drinks, anything hard, anything to be inhale anything, drugs, any intoxicant that is called in Arabic al-khamr is haram in Islam. Any aggression on the human soul and the human body and the jawarih and the aql and all is haram. Any aggression in terms of what you say, you know, foul language, etc., al-qadh, accusing people falsely, defamation, all of this is haram, and so on. So there is a definition of haram, of sin in Islam that is part of the ta'abudiyat, part of the acts of worship and the rituals in Islam. But not everything in Islam is ritual, because most of the aspects of life are not actually ritual. They don't fall under the qat'iyat, under the fixed and immutable parts of Islam. They are free for us to develop and think about. And if we don't have this attention to maqasid al-sharia, what we will do, we will borrow philosophies from non-Islamic origins. Doesn't mean that they are all wrong, but they come from a different worldview. They come from a different understanding of God and earth and human life and what is right and what is wrong. This is unfortunately what's happening now because of the lack of appreciation and attention to the meaning and the philosophy of Sharia, Maqasid Sharia. We are borrowing the economic philosophy from others. So the Islamic economics is either capitalist or communist or socialist. You find some people preaching socialism in the name of Islam or preaching capitalism in the name of Islam. And when we deal with the law is either French or English or German. So we go to Europe and we take one of the philosophies of law and we make a legal system, not based on our meanings and our maqasid and our purposes, and the purpose, of course, of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in making legislation. No, we borrow legislation from East and West. When we deal with arts, we either go postmodern or we go modernist arts or we go and so on. And we copy the philosophies of arts, and therefore a lot of the meaning and a lot of the morals and a lot of the ethics of arts from others. And that is unacceptable. If we go to Maqasid al-Sharia and we look at the meaning in Islam, at the purposes from the names of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and His attributes to Maqasid al-Quran, what the Quran intended, by everything from talking about nature and the environment and history to the Maqasid of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, then we will start to have an appreciation of the philosophical side of Islam, and therefore we can build Islamic curricula, we build a pedagogy that takes a Muslim to contemporary times without compromising what Islam is about. Take a Muslim to contemporary times from within Islam. We have fallen into a number of schools. All of them are not Islamic and they don't integrate all the Islamic knowledge into our students in our Islamic education. We either fall into the past and the literal copying of the past, literal copying of fatwa, literal copying of siyasa shar'iyya, literal copying of the kinds of companies and the kinds of economy that is allowed, sometimes even literal copying of war and peace and its methods and all of that. And all of this is wrong. This takes us to a different era that is in the past and therefore makes us much weaker than others who live in the contemporary times. There's a very different definition of trade and economics and medicine and arts than the past. And therefore, if you dwell in the past and take the letter of the past as Sharia without looking at the maqsood, then we fall into the literal school that does not develop Muslim societies. That's one school. The other school is the secular school that says that no, we cannot do with Islam as in the past. We have to follow Europe and America as they are, and we have to develop as they developed and all of that, and separate Islam from public life. And that is also another mistake, because no, we cannot copy other people's frameworks and worldviews, because they have a different history and different religions and different ways of looking into things. Our civilization in the Islamic world, whether for Muslim or non-Muslim, who lived in the Islamic civilization, I'm talking about Islam as a civilization now has certain characteristics and certain morals and certain worldview and understanding that is different from others. And when we copy from others, we make others occupy us intellectually before they occupy us economically and militarily. And the economic and military occupation starts with the intellectual occupation. As our mashayikh used to call it, al-ghazw al-fikri, the intellectual battle, the intellectual war that they have. And it's very true. But if we look from within Islam into the philosophy of Islam, and we try to develop a curriculum in our Islamic education and an agenda for our Islamic parties and Islamic movements that is contemporary and at the same time Islamic, by looking at maqasid al-sharia, by looking at the ahkam in the public life as means to an end and not as ends in their own right. And therefore, we can develop the means as much as we can, as long as we keep the ends, as long as we look at the purposes and putting them central stage. We can develop different means of doing things and different tools and different technologies based on the purposes that we define. This is very important, because otherwise we fall into one of these two extremes, whether the literal extreme that lives in the past or the secular postmodern kind of deconstructive extreme that is trying to deconstruct ethics and morals and make us just followers to others who have a different worldview and different beliefs. Maqasid al-Sharia, finally, is very important for ijtihad. I understand that there is a group of you, I'm not sure, brothers and sisters or brothers only, or I understand that a group of you does ijtihad, inshallah, for brothers and sisters who do ijtihad. It is essential that you know maqasid al-Sharia, because your ijtihad has to be compatible with with Islam's al-kulliyat, with the bigger picture of Islam. You cannot have an ijtihad that defies justice, or defies mercy, or defies common good, or defies the interest of the family, that destroys a family or destroys a mosque. You cannot have an ijtihad that has a purpose that goes against the bigger and higher purposes in Islam. Imam Ibn al-Qayyim has a great sentence that I always mention, in which he says, "Ash-shari'atu adlun kulluha wa rahmatun kulluha wa hikmatun kulluha wa maslahatun kulluha." Sharia is all about justice, all about mercy, all about wisdom, and all about good. فكل مسألة, he says, خرجت بالشريعة عن العدل إلى الجور وعن الحكمة إلى ضدها وعن المصلحة إلى المفسدة فليست من الشريعة. Then he says, every opinion that takes Sharia from being about justice to being about injustice, from being about mercy to being about its opposite, from being about wisdom to being about futility, or from being about good to being about mischief, then it is not Sharia. وَإِنْ أُدْخِلَتْ فِيهَا بِالتَّأْوِيلِ, even if somebody claims so according to an interpretation. The interpretation has to be compatible with maqasid al-Sharia. The application of the Sharia has to be compliant with maqasid al-Sharia. Otherwise, it is not Sharia compliant. It is some understanding and interpretation that goes against the maqsood, against the higher principles of Islam, and the higher principles should take central stage. SubhanAllah, I wish that I could have been there for more hours and more talk and more days of interaction. Inshallah, it might happen in the future. Inshallah, pray for us. And please connect with me. The world now is a very small village. Connect with me via any social media. I answer my emails. I answer my Facebook and Twitter messages. So connect with me, inshallah, wherever you wish. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give you success for your seminar. And jazakallah khair, all my brothers, the organizers of this great work. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless you and bless our ummah. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us the best final moments in this world, so that we meet with Him in happiness and in good. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.